Alright, so in yesterday's class, we were looking at the topic of carry, save, adder. Right? So the idea behind it is something like this. The structure of a regular ripple carry adder would be something of this sort. Right? Taking two inputs. A and B, which are let's say 4 bits each in this case, a carry input from outside, and the carry internally ripples through all the 4 stages, finally generating a carry output and 4 sum bits. So this is the regular ripple carry adder. Right? And all the other adder architectures that we looked at were essentially some ways of speeding up this long ripple carry, the long carry path through the entire circuit. What the carry save adder does is to say that we change this structure slightly. So what you have is 2 4 bit inputs as before. But now the carry input, right, is rather than feeding from one stage to the next, you take that also as a separate input to the system. So this becomes a carry in. This becomes, or rather, instead of calling it carry in, I'll just call it C0, C1, C2, and C3. So this is effectively another 4 bit input that comes to the system. Okay. And as far as output is concerned, as before, of course, you have the S0, S1, S2, S3. But now the output carries, instead of feeding into the next stage, are just taken as outputs of the system. So effectively what ends up happening is you take 3 4 bit inputs and generate 2 4 bit outputs. Okay. This is called a carry save adder. Right? Now of course one thing should be clear, if I take the output of the carry save adder and feed it into a regular adder with the 4 bit carry shifted to the left by 1 and then just use ripple carry addition, the result will be the proper sum of the 3 values that were fed into the carry save adder to start with. Okay, so please look at it and convince yourself of that. Okay, you take the outputs of a carry save adder appropriately shifted. What I mean by appropriately shifted is that the carry, the 4 bit carry has to be shifted left with comparison to the 4 bit sum. Feed that into a regular adder and you will get the proper adder output, the sum of the 3 values that were fed into the carry save adder to start with. Okay. The big advantage of this of course is the critical path. In this case the critical path in the ripple carry adder, the critical path is all the way through. Whereas over here, it is just this much. Right? Either C0, C1, C2, C3, it doesn't matter, they are all the same. They are all one full adder, effectively. Right? So the carry save adder is going to execute much faster, but it's not doing a complete addition. It's doing a part of the store. Okay? So let's see what this would look like if we were considering a specific case of adding 4 numbers together. Let's say the numbers that you want to add are 0001 plus 0111 plus 1101 plus 0010. Okay? All unsigned numbers. So don't worry about 2's complement, negative, overflow, all that stuff. Just treat them as unsigned numbers and add. Okay? So, with carry save addition, what we are essentially going to end up doing is feed the first three inputs directly to a 4-bit carry save adder. Okay? What happens? Rightmost column 1 plus 1 plus 1, the sum output is going to be 1, the carry output is also going to be 1. Right? Rather than carrying it over to the next phase, I will write it down here. Okay? And the first level of the carry, I'll just leave it as a blank because it needs to be left shifted by 1. Okay? The second one, 0 plus 1 plus 0, the sum is equal to 1, carry is equal to 0. Okay? At the third stage, 0 plus 1 plus 1, the sum is 0, the carry out is equal to 1. And then 0 plus 0 plus 1, the sum is 1, the carry is 0. Okay? So I have finished the first level of carry save addition of the first three numbers. Now I take the fourth number. But now I need to feed it to a 5-bit CSA. The reason being that the carry is effectively 5 bits. It has been shifted left by 1, which effectively means that with respect to the other numbers, it is 5 bits. Okay? I am still going to use the CSA because I need to add 3 numbers together. What does the CSA output of this look like? 1. And the carry out at the first stage is 0. 1 plus 1 plus 1, the sum is equal to 1, carry out is also equal to 1. Okay? 0 plus 0 plus 0 is 0. 1 plus 1 plus 0, the sum is 0, carry is 1. Okay? And the final stage is 0 plus 0 plus 0 again. So, this. Now I have reduced my requirement to just the final two numbers alone to be added. Okay? Here I don't use carry save addition. I just use regular carry propagate addition, and let's say that I'll use a repeat carry adder. Okay? Nothing preventing you from using one of the faster adders, of course, maybe one of the pre-structured adders to reduce speed. The point is, it has to be a complete addition, not a carry save type of addition. Okay? And when you add these, so this is regular addition 1, 1, 1, 0, 1. And there is an extra 0 over here which is overflow. So 10111 is the final answer. So this is what you get when you add the four numbers that were written at the top. Okay. So effectively what we did was two stages of carry save addition, where three numbers at a time are added together. The critical path through the carry save addition is very short, just one full adder delay. Okay. Followed by, once we have reduced the once the carry save adders have reduced the requirement to just two numbers to be added, you use a regular carry propagate adder. Okay? So now, where does this kind of thing get used? And where, as you are going to see very soon, the main place where you need to add large sets of numbers together like this is when you are trying to multiply numbers together. Okay. So carry save adders naturally form an important component of multipliers. Okay. So before getting into that, let's take a look at how you would do multiplication of two numbers. Okay. So let's say that I want to multiply two decimal numbers. Okay. Let's say 12 into 34. How do you do it? You would first take the 4, multiply by the 12, right? So 4 into 2, 8, 4 into 1, 4. Then usually you would put a blank or a cross or something over here to indicate that it has to shift 1 to the left, right? Because 1 power of 10 extra corresponding to the 3, right? And then multiply the 3 into 12. So 3 2s are 6, 3 1s are 1, oh, 3 1s are 3. And now add these together. Okay? So you get 8, 0, 4. Okay? The same thing holds, let's say that we are trying to do binary multiplication. Okay? Let's say I have 1 1 0 0 into 0 1 0 1. Once again, unsigned number. Right? So only positive. How would I do this? 1 times 1100 is 1100 itself. Then 0 times 110 is 0. 1 times 110 is 1100. And the last one is 0000. Okay? Add. So what I get is 0011111. Okay? So a couple of things to observe over here. The first one is each of these is 4 bits. Okay? The result in this case is 7 bits. In reality, there could have been an overflow at the last stage to give me 8 bits. So in the worst case, my product could have been up to 8 bits. Right? In general, n bits multiplied by n bits will give you a result which has n plus n bits. Okay, so the important thing to note over here is what we ended up doing, the way that we did the multiplication was to generate a set of so-called partial products. Okay, line up those partial products appropriately by shifting if required and add them. Okay, so this kind of structure where you just basically put down a whole bunch of partial products and just line them up together and add them, this kind of multiplication is called the basic form of array multiplication or an array multiplier. Right? Why is it an array multiplier? What you are doing is you are generating all the partial products, putting them down into an array of numbers. Right, a grid, a regular spacing of the numbers, followed by addition. Right, there are two things to observe here. One of them is you can straight away see how carry save addition is going to be useful over here. Right, because you have to add across columns a large set of numbers. Right, so rather than doing repeat carry addition or carry propagate addition at each stage, you do carry save until the last stage where you do a regular carry propagate addition. Okay? So that is one possibility that definitely strikes you. The second thing is, how do you generate the partial product? What is the operation required for generating partial products over here? Just AND. Okay? So if you look at these things, how did I generate 1100 multiplied by 1? Since the multiplier in this case, by the way, a little bit of terminology. This is usually called the multiplier. Right? And this is called the multiplicand. Does not matter too much, but this is terminology that you will generally see used in practice. The idea is that the multiplier is taken one or more bits at a time and used in order to multiply the multiplicand. It's actually completely symmetric because multiplication after all is a commutative operation. Right? It doesn't matter in which order you do it. A into B and B into A are the same. Okay, for division example, it would be different. The divisor and the dividend would be two different things. You have to keep them separate. For multiplication, it does not really matter. Okay? But still, the terminology is used in this. So now, how do you generate the partial product? By just using an AND operation. Okay? Of course, not just one AND operation. I need to have N AND operations in order to generate the first row of partial product. N AND operations to generate the next row of partial product. So, overall, what is the total number of AND operations to be done? If it's an N into N bit multiplication, how many AND operations would I need? N squared. Right? Because at each row I have to generate N elements of the partial product and I have to generate N such partial products because the multiplier is N. Okay? So N squared partial product or N into N partial product partial product term M partial products, assuming that M is the number of bits in the multiplier, and addition of all of those together. Okay, so the basic concept of multiplication is very obvious and very simple to implement, right? What would be the critical path through something like this? There's another way of representing this which you will often see in practice, which is something called a dot diagram. So what this basically says is, supposing you have 4 bit multiplication, these are the partial products. Okay, and they need to get added together to generate the final result. Okay, what would the critical path be like for this? Even if you were to just use carry propagate addition everywhere. If you think about it carefully, what you can see is that the critical path would effectively be something of this sort. Right? Because in the worst case, the carry needs to propagate through all of those stages and then needs to go through the successive stages because that is going to be the final longest path through the addition. Okay? So just think about this a little bit more. How exactly does the worst case critical path come up in this case? And how does it become that this is the longest path through the circuit? Okay. Now the important thing is, critical path is proportional to N. For an N cross N multiplication. With N cross N, it's proportional to N plus N. Okay, so definitely what we can see from this is that the critical path is longer than in the case of a simple adder. There is more computation, the total hardware is going to be about N squared instead of N, right? So if an adder had complexity or had an area requirement of some N, right, the area requirement of the multiplier will be something N squared. Okay, because the number of partial product units that are required over there goes as N squared. Okay. Now, so far we have looked only at unsigned array multiplication, which was very easy to do. We just generated the partial products, added them together. Right. One of the complications that comes up in multiplication is, which is not so much there in addition. In addition, if I wanted to subtract two numbers, how would I do it? Take the 2's complement and add, right? So the 2's complement effectively converts a positive number to its equivalent negative value. So subtraction can be taken as first convert the number to a negative value and add. Okay? What do you do in the case of multiplication? In multiplication, it's a little bit more tricky because what happens effectively is that the most significant bit is what determines whether or not the number is negative. Okay? And that needs to be handled separately from the rest of the bits in the multiplication. Right? So in order to understand that, let's take a closer look at 2's complement numbers. What is the normal thing for 2's complement? What we say is minus, supposing 5 is 0, 1, 0, 1. Minus 5 we say is 0, 1, 0, 1, the whole complement plus 1. Right? So 1, 0, 1, 0 plus 1 or 1, 0, 1, 1. The important thing to keep in mind over here is this is just a representation. The number 1011 does not fundamentally mean minus 5. 1011 is just a code. How we interpret it is up to us. Okay? You can choose to interpret it either as 11 or as minus 5 depending on whether you are treating it as a signed or unsigned or signed number. Right? You might also have some other totally different number representation which says that 1011 is something else altogether, but that's out of scope of what we are doing over here. Right? The important thing is this is a representation. And it's a question of how we interpret the number. Okay? So now supposing I have in general a n bit number. What is the value of this number if I was to convert it into a, let's say that this is unsigned. How would I write the value of this number? I need to take x0 multiply it by 2 power 0, x1 multiply it by 2 power 1, x2 multiply it by 2 power 2 and so on. Right? So this would become a summation x5 2 power I for I going from 0 up to n minus 1, assuming that this is an unsigned number. Okay? But for 2's complement, effectively what happens is that most significant bit, the n minus 1, that determines whether the number is positive or negative. Right? Actually what happens is, if the number is 1, it means that the number value is negative. The equivalent value then the equivalent value is this, right? This would be the positive value. This is the 2's complement. And this is the negative sign. Right? If you write this out, then effectively what happens is, for a 2's complement number, in general, value of a 2's complement number, can be written as, take the with n minus 1 alone with a negative sign, but the rest of the values are with a positive sign. Okay? Look at what happened in the expression that we wrote at the top of the page. Right? If xn minus 1 is equal to 0, there is no minus anywhere, the result is positive. If xn minus 1 is equal to 1, then that minus 2 power n minus 1 is going to drown out everything else which is there in the summation and make the net result negative, which is the correct value that it represents. Okay? So in general, this is a compact way of representing the value of a 2's complement number irrespective of what the xn minus 1 is. Whether it's 0 or 1, this will give you the correct value. Okay? So based on this particular representation, there were two people called Baugh and Woolley who came up with a representation for the multiplier which said for negative numbers or for 2's complement numbers, we can use this kind of a representation and use the same kind of array multiplier in order to build up a complete multiplier that will work for both positive as well as negative numbers. Okay? So this is known as the Baugh-Woolley multiplication algorithm. Right? What it says is, I'll treat two numbers . These are the two numbers to be multiplied. Okay? What do I do? Expand this out. Okay, expand algebraically, just expand out this expression. Not to the full extent of, you know, all the n minus 2 and n minus 2 different values. Treat those as a block and write out the expression for the final value. What this effectively becomes is double summation. Path is the same as a regular array multiplier, right? These are only positive values that you are dealing with. But then comes m minus 1, the y n minus 1 into x n minus 1. Into 2 to the power of m plus n minus 2. Okay. Then there are two negative terms. So the y n minus 1 is multiplied by all the positive part of the x, 0 up to n minus 2, and the x n minus 1 is multiplied by the positive part of the y from 0 up to n minus 2. Okay? And the entire thing is combined together. Right? What does this look like in terms of what we would write out the partial product? I'm going to consider two 4-bit numbers and write out this partial product in detail for this. Right? So what I have is right? The first level of partial product would be corresponding to this first term, right? What I have is only up to n minus 2 I'm supposed to go, right? So x0, y0, x1, y0, x2, y0. That's it. I don't do the x3 because the x3 corresponds to the bit that determines whether it's positive or negative. Okay? So these terms have been put down in place. Then we'll get to the second term last, right? Because that's the corresponds to multiplication by 2 power n plus n minus 2. So the place value, the position, is going to be to the extreme left. Okay, so we'll get to that later. Let's consider the second one. We need to subtract a value. Rather than subtracting, what we are going to do is we will generate that partial product, take its 2's complement and write down the 2's complement in that case. Okay, it's the same thing, right? After all, for subtraction, what do? You take 2's complement of a number and add. So let's straight away write down the 2's complement of the number over here. X0, Y3, bar, right? I'm complementing bit by bit. X1, Y3, bar. X2, Y3, bar. Okay? But it's 2's complement. So all the other bits, the lower order bits, which would have been zeros, why am I writing it over here? Because this is multiplied by 2 power I plus N minus 1. Remember? The whole thing has to be multiplied by 2 power N minus 1. Or 2 power 3 in this case. How do I multiply by 2 power 3? I shift to the left by 3 positions. Right? Give it a place value of 8. Okay? Which means that these lower order bits would all have been 1. And there is a 1 that I would need to add for the 2's complement. Okay? Same way, I would then have x3, y0, x3, y1, x3, y2, and the 2's complement of that, which corresponds to the last term. And then this 2 power m plus n minus 2. What is m plus n minus 2? In this case, it is 4 plus 4 minus 2. So that is 6. So 2 power 6 is the weightage given to the x3, y3 term. Right? So leave 6 positions, put x3, y3 over here. Without any complementing. Add all of these. Right? And what we get is there will be a partial product, zero, not partial product, the final product. Right? One thing to keep in mind is because of the x3, y3, you need to extend all the numbers to the left also. When you are extending a regular, a positive number, you just put zeros. Right? But when you are extending a negative number, you have to put 1's over there. Why 1? Because the most significant bit is already a 1. You are taking the, or rather the value that you had, what number that you are then taking the 2's complement of. When you sign extend, or rather when you extend it to the left, you would normally have put zeros, but when you do the inversion for 2's complement, they will all become 1. Okay? This is called sign extension. Okay. So this structure, the array multiplication, is what is known as the Bob-Woolley multiplier. It's a fairly straightforward extension of array multiplication to handle negative numbers as well. Okay. It turns out that many of these, you have a lot of ones over here, right? Instead of putting them into the adder and then doing the multiplication later, you can actually compact the entire thing, make it a bit more reduced in size, because all the ones can be pre-computed. Adding up the ones can be computed ahead of time, and the result can just be stored as a direct bit, right? So this structure can be compacted slightly. I'm not going to go into that in class now. You can look it up in the textbook. It's a fairly simple extension to this, which makes the Bob-Woolley multiplier a little bit more compact. Okay. Now, okay. So that takes us to the next algorithm that we want to consider, where we say, by generating these partial products, why do it one bit at a time? Why not try and do it in groups of 2 bits at a time from the multiplier? Right? So in other words, supposing I have B7 to B0 needs to be multiplied by A7, A6, A5, A4 up to A0. The normal way of generating partial products will be take A0 multiplied by B7 to B0. Then take A1 multiplied by B7 to B0 and so on. Instead, what I'm going to say is I'll take groups of 2 bits over here, right? And say A1, A0 actually has the value 2A1 plus A0 multiplied by B. Okay? I'll add to this 2A3 plus A2 multiplied by B. This has to be multiplied by 4^1, because that A3 A2 combination has a place value of 4, right? For unsigned numbers, this expression is true. Okay? What's the advantage of doing this approach? How do I generate that partial product 2a1 plus a0 times b? Do I need to actually do some 2a1 plus a0 multiply by b, or is there some quicker way by which I can generate the partial product? It's not a very complicated thing, right? Multiplying by 2a1 plus a0, 2a1 plus a0 is, first of all, I just take those 2 bits. Maybe I can use them as a select input to a multiplexer, and in the multiplexer, I give 4 values, 0, B, 2B, 3B. I get this. So this is my partial product generator. Okay. So the partial product generator can be looked at as a multiplexer, which essentially takes 4 values, 0, B, 2B and 3B, and selects one of them as a partial product. Okay. So this kind of partial product is not very difficult to do. By doing this, the number of partial products has become half of what it was earlier. Which means that your critical path, instead of going through n stages, now needs to go only through n/2 stages and then ripple through the rest of it. So that could be a significant saving in the addition through n of those stages that we need to do. Okay? So this kind of a thing is definitely something that we would like to see. One problem with this approach is in the partial product generation. Zero is fine. That just means I connect everything to ground. B is also fine because I have the value, the multiplicand. I have it ready with me. I can just feed that entire value as one input to the multiplexer. 2B is also easy to do because shifting something by to the left by one place is equivalent to multiplying by 2. 3B is slightly tricky. What do I need to do? I need to shift left and add. So an extra addition comes in there just for generating the partial product. Okay? So that 3B is one slightly problematic partial product that we would like to avoid if possible. So because of that, so by the way, what we have done over here, right, combining two bits at a time, this is known as boot recoding or boot encoding, right? Once again named after the person who first proposed it. The idea is, instead of taking partial products with one bit at a time over the multiplier, take with more than one bit at a time. In this case, two bits, you could also do three bits at a time and so on. Right? Why would you do this? Because generating those partial products is still quite easy to do. But the number of partial products has become half of what it was earlier. So there can be a considerable savings in your critical path time if you implement this properly. Okay? Now, one problem is this doesn't handle negative numbers properly because it should not be 2A7, right? The A7 actually has a negative value. It has the value of minus 2. Okay? So, if I want to handle that properly, the approach that is used is something called a modified boot encoding, where what we do is, the number A7 up to A0 has the value minus 2^7 A7 plus 2^6 A6 plus 2^5 A5 so on up to 2^0 A0. Right? I am going to rewrite this into groups of 3 bits at a time and say minus 2A7 plus A6 plus A5 times 4^3. Minus 2A5 plus A4 plus A3 times 4^2. Minus 2A3 plus A2 plus A1 times 4^1. Minus 2A1 plus A0 plus I'll write A-1 just for regularity, where A-1 is assumed to be 0. Right, multiplied by 4^0. Yeah. Minus, what is it? Yes. No. Because I have got A5 again in the next term over there. I have got a plus A5 into 4^3 over here. And I have got a minus 2A5 into 4^2. Okay. So what is the value over here? This is A5 into 2^6. This gives me minus 2A5 into 2^4. Okay. So this overall becomes A5 into 2^6 minus 2^5 is equal to A5 into 2^5. Okay. So this is important. The fact that you were able to group those things together, as you pointed out, otherwise it would have to be A5 by 2, right? You are taking the place value of numbers. Now I am specifically writing it in a way such that the A5 has a value of 1 in the previous case and 1 in the next one as well. So it contributes to two different partial product terms. But you can see that there is a regularity over here, right? These terms are all completely regular. Okay? So I can once again build that same kind of multiplexer type of structure and say I'll build one such partial product generator by considering these terms 3 bits at a time as my select input. Okay? What's the advantage of this recoding? It turns out that if you go through all the possible combinations, right? When it's 0, 0, 0, it is 0. When it's 0, 0, 1, it is just the value b which will come as the partial product. When it is 0, 1, 0, also it will be b as the partial product. 0, 1, 1, it will be 2b. For 1, 0, 0, it becomes minus 2b. Then minus b, and once again 0. These are the coefficients for the boot encoding, right? What's the big difference that you see here with respect to the previous one? There is no 3B term. There is only 0B, minus B, 2B and minus 2B. B and minus B are easy to create. B is already there, minus B is just a 2's complement of that. Same way, 2B is also easy to generate because it's a left shift of B. And minus 2b is also easy, it's the 2's complement of that. Okay? So what we have done is, by using this new recoding of the number, we have created a way by which we can generate these partial products without having to generate a 3b term, which requires an extra addition. Okay? So this is a more compact form. This is known as a modified Booth. Algorithm or modified Booth encoding. Right? Where essentially what we say is, we are going to combine 3 bits at a time with some overlap in order to generate all the partial products that we need. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. And there's one more small topic with regard to multipliers that needs to be finished up. I'll finish that in the next class.